Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I think we start with the surgical sessions after the other clinical work which has been discussed in the previous session. So we have a keynote address, setting up a wet lab and introducing the Oscar, Dr. Sunil.
Thank you. I thank the organizers and Dr. Partha Biswas and everybody who's worked hard. Some of my disclosures are, I'm with the CPD and CME committee, and we run courses for teachers, and some of these courses are paid. So otherwise, there are no other disclosures that I have to make. So like we talk about presentations, there has to be an attention grabbing slide. So a doctor watched surgery on YouTube before he performed a surgery which went fatal and the patient died, and there was a lawsuit, and it was found that he had never done a surgery, and he had just seen it on YouTube and then done the surgery. So this is something that we are talking about. So the objectives are, the participants at the end of the presentation should be able to enumerate 4 objective tests for surgical competence assessment, use ICO Oscar for own students, state 4 differences between direct and video observation, and state 2 and 2 pros and 2 cons for video observation. So I'm not going to go through the pretest, but just keep in mind. So the point of this pretest or the question is that what is better, direct or video observation? So keep this in mind when you're looking through the presentation, and what are the objectives and advantages, and why does surgical recording for teaching purpose need a consent? So these are the things. So we know that the surgeon training and learning curve is pretty steep, and because of this, we may have complications in patients. And we know that there are certain surgeries in which there are key steps that you want to focus on. So when we are looking at complications, we look at, when we are talking about teaching and we are looking at assessment of whether the teaching is proper or not, we look at 4 key steps, which are the ones which cause complications in most surgeries, in most students. So like the incision, so you have either a tunnel which is a premature entry, or sometimes it is a tunnel which is the roof is too thin. Sometimes you have a capsular excess running through, sometimes fecal emulsification drops, and irrigation aspiration and PC rents during those times. So you identify through videos what are the steps in which most complications occur, and then you do something about improving those steps, observe those steps, and try to figure out how you can help the resident. So what we did start looking at is what is the effectiveness of setting up numerical targets. You have to do at least 40 surgeries before you come out into the open. You have to do at least 100 surgeries. So when we realize that this may not be essential, if you can do at least 10 surgeries, but in a very structured manner, something which has been handheld and with the help of an Oscar. So you look at what is called as a progress rate. You have to look at the average progress rate and the increase in the average points. Now, this is something as a slide. So you see that there is one resident, A, who falls into the cube very well. So there are trabeculectomies done, DCR, pterygium, turbinectomies, vitrectomy, other things, whereas the other one is skewed. So I become an eye surgeon. I don't want to be just with biceps. All I have is biceps, cataract surgery. No, I should be knowing all the other surgeries also. I should know vitrectomy, I should know pterygium, I should know other things also. So my triceps, my abs, my other things also. So there's been overall development. You can't literally focus only on cataract surgery. So when we look at this, when we're trying to deal with all types of surgeries, you want to look at whether you can give few surgeries of each type and whether that can be assessed in a way to figure out whether where the student lies. So we started off with OSS. So I'm going through the history. We started off with OSS. OSS was a global rating score. So you will not be able to read this, but this is how the score used to be. So you had respect for tissue, and then you had time and motion, and you had knowledge and other things. And then you've put them across as 1 to 5 according to the Dreyfus scale. So I'll come to the Dreyfus scale. That shifted on to OSS. After that, it shifted on to this kind of a form in which you had too many things to fill. And then you had, you identified himself, you identified the options, described the procedures, identified risks, and how you did it as a novice or a beginner or an expert. Now, based on this, you would rather be, so according to the Dreyfus scale, you could be neither novice, beginner, advanced beginner, proficient, or expert. So you're starting, so your desire to learn, what you have seen videos and all, demonstrate microscope use, then you become a beginner. Advanced beginner, you can demonstrate 5 cases less than 45 minutes. Then proficient, you can do less than 30 minutes, 5 cases. And here you can do small pupil and other complicated cases also. So this is a scale, novice, beginner, advanced beginner, professional, and expert. And you're given, when we moved from OSACS to OSCAR, we moved into levels describing and breaking the surgery into various parts, draping, incision and paracentesis, viscoelastic, capsular excess. So what you did according to your level, so you are unable to drape with minimal verbal instructions, your lashes are completely, mostly covered, one lash coming out, all lashes covered, no lash coming out. And then you had to do this, so you are competent, no lash coming out. You are doing a viscoelastic capsular excess, it's circular. There's no eccentricity anywhere. So based on this, you are given a score of 5. And when you score an overall 5 everywhere, so it's like gymnastics. So you got 10, 10, 10, 10, and you are Nadia Comaneci. You can juggle around inside the gymnastics in your anterior chamber and do whatever you want and come out with a full 10, full 10, full 10 in each step. So on the bars, full 10, on the floor, full 10. And that is a complicated thing to follow. So what we went into is direct observation. We look at videos instead of direct observation, the surgeon sitting there, most of us don't have time. So you started looking at videos. So between direct observation where, which is the most commonest thing, there were shortcomings that you had multiple trainees. I had 10 people to do and I can't sit and do that complicated thing and ask that person to be Nadia Comaneci and try to make a Nadia Comaneci out of one person. I have 15 people to train. Observers cannot be masked, and when I was a student, when my teacher used to watch, my hand used to tremor, and if you tell me that there's a recording going on, my voice will start tremoring, and then I'll start talking very fast, and then I will get a complication. So these are shortcomings. So this is a surgery which is being done. What do you think? This is novice or expert? You look at the tremors, you look at the way the tissue is being handled, you look at movements which are happening, jerky movements. So based on this, you look at 4 or 5 things and you will be able to say what this is. What do you think? What does everybody think? Novice or expert? Versus video observation, which is done after some time. So video observation, which is done immediately, video observation, which is done after some time. So you want to make out whether this Sachin Tendulkar played properly or not. You will go back, take a slow motion, be a commentator, and then say, let's look at the highlights again. And he went outside the off-stump unnecessarily, and which is something that you didn't realize when you were commenting directly during the live show, right? So video observation in which trainee's performance is recorded and later evaluated, the method provides the assessor with enough time. So most of the time, when I'm looking at a student, the only thing that I'm thinking, abhi drop hoega, 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 down. And I'm not even thinking about, what was that? I had to see this thing. Kya dekhna tha mereko? Achha, wo circular hai ki nahi dekhna tha? Arre, incision to main dekhna bhulega. Kaisa tha wo? Kaisa tha? I mean, I don't remember. So you have to video record and then go and slow motion, fast forward, back, go back again, rewind, and then see it again. That becomes much easier. When I do that, and I can do that, and I can take video grabs now, and I can put it into an artificial intelligence, and I allow the machine to tell me. Movements kitna tha? Ek instrument ke upar dusra instrument tha kya? Instrument were away from each other. Was it 45 degrees? Were you doing it the right way? So that you can, there are increased complexities that you can then address. You can do instrument tracking strategies, whether the instrument was shaking, I may not realize it from outside or a side scope, but the machine and the AI will realize it, whether the instrument was shaking. You see videos and then you see this is how the draping is occurring, and this is a wrong draping occurring here because, and the wrong, this thing, it is going from inside out. So you're taking all the muck from the sac area and you're putting it all over the eye. So this is something that I have not realized when this was happening in front of me, but when I'm looking at the video, I'm like, oh, ulta, 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 it is from lateral to medial. So small things like this will get missed when you're like, drop, wait, come up, out, move, I will do the surgery. No? So that is something. So then you look at levels and scores, and then there are times when we Snapchat it, so the youngsters will be interested. So they take a spectacle and they record the surgery and they Snapchat it to me, sir, mera last surgery. You have to be careful because privacy is not guaranteed and somebody's got arrested for Snapchat. But Snapchat is still better because it will get deleted. So there is no way it can be traced back to you, right? So somebody did a Snapchat for a plastic surgery. Obviously, if I'm doing a breast reconstruction or a prostatectomy, I'll be shot in the head if I do a Snapchat. I'm not supposed to do that. It has to be done with proper patient consent, right? So summarizing, objective scoring of residents can be done easier by OSCARS, video OSCARS specifically. Balance needs to be maintained. Video observation may have a great role to play, but you have to keep in mind HIPAA issues and privacy and consent issues. Now going to the next thing, that once you've done, once this was supposed to be setting up the lab first and then the Oscars, because then you're supposed to see that, but I changed the order because once you know that this is what you're planning to do, then your wet lab will be something that helps you do what we were doing in the first stage, and the same thing has to be done in the wet lab also. So this is something that most people don't see. Most of the wet labs are just time pass because eyes are not going to be lost. It's anyways a pig's eye, it's anyways a cow's eye. So kya farak padta hai? Karo tumko jo karna hai wo. And so your same things have to happen during the wet lab also. So wet lab is a very specialized thing. It's not just something that you go and a conference and then you go and move your hand around on some pig's eye and then get out and say, okay, fine, I got a certificate saying that I'm good in, trained in Ologen or trained in Amazwal. Right? So the objectives is your three rationals, importance of curriculum. The curriculum is what is important. Six types of wet labs which can be set up, and six steps of setting up a wet lab, and three funding possibilities locally, and four ways of maintaining sustainability. Because you can have a wet lab, but you cannot sometimes have a sustainability. So what's the purpose of the wet lab? I'll just take 2 minutes. Can I? Yeah. So what is the purpose of the wet lab? It decreases the surgical complications at the beginning of beginning surgeons that can harm the patients, and it facilitates adaptation to new techniques. So when you're learning, you have to demand this, or maybe you can do this on your own if you're a resident, but if you're a teacher, you are supposed to do this for the students. So why do we need a wet lab? Because the patient can practice at own pace. The student can practice his own pace and abilities. I want to do the tunnel four times. I can do tunnel four times on the same patient, but I can do tunnel four times on the pig's eye, right? It is without danger stress, and it develops skills, develops coordination, and arrive better prepared to your first patient, right? The rationale is it's a structured training. Steep learning curves in some procedures are deleted and they don't become steep. The primum non necessary, first no harm is something, so no lies are lost, eyes are lost in training. And the consent for allowing training, patients may not give sometimes. This is my resident who's going to do on you. Nobody might consent on that. So we are doing that without consent. So that's something that should not be done. And minimal surgical training requirement is required. So the learning problem we see, this is before the number of cases, more less than 60 cases, that's a complication rate, more than 60 cases. Less than 80 cases, more than 80 cases, the complication rate. So you know that the number of cases, are better to the cases on the pig's eye. So you do the wet lab, you prepare written curriculums, you know that we are going to do this. Do not make it optional, schedule a time in advance and either block clinic time or afterwards. A structured wet lab will have a goal and objective, pre and post didactic testing. So you will do a didactic, you're supposed to do this, you're supposed to do this. So when you go in for the wet lab here, the reason why I was talking here, because there's going to be a wet lab here, you insist that, sir, please tell me what I'm supposed to do. Then let me do. And then after that, please tell me what I did right and tell me what I did wrong, right? And there are faculty sessions should be every week when you're doing it in your this thing. So design template, a template should be there for each case. What is the reason you're doing this surgery in this particular pig? So this pig has got glaucoma and this is the case. This what should be achieved, you are supposed to achieve without tearing the conjunctiva. What are the features of this procedure that make it different from trabeculectomy instead of discectomy? Why this Ologen is better or why this thing is there? And review the understanding. Types of wet lab, anatomical, hand-eye coordination, steps of surgery, to be demonstrated, simulation machines, VR wet labs, and augmented wet labs. So I'll just run through one of these. That's the five things. Anatomy for endoscopy. While I'm teaching endoscopy, I take the students first to the endoscopy lab. Then you look at the practice session where your surgical instrument training, you hold the instrument, hold and show me video recording of this holding, movements of the eye. You're holding the pen like, you're holding the instrument like this. This is not going to work. You're supposed to hold the instrument like this. You're holding it too far. You're holding it too near. So that's a wet lab, right? So how do you hold the instrument? Then how you do the suturing techniques on a plastic or this thing? That's another type of thing. Yeah. And cadaveric plus this thing, simulated work. And six steps, your physical space. You have to obtain eyes. Be careful when you are doing it with corona virus around, when you're taking pig's eyes or something like that. Fix the eyes. Feedback is important. Find so one lab in Johnson & Johnson in Mumbai has closed down because it's not sustainable, so funding is important. You look at video presentation, skill transfer, group discussion, then you're talking about simulators. You have VR in surgical training, there's no time, and training in OT. So training in OT is something that is also done as a wet lab, and you have to remember that that is also a part of the wet lab. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Arvind, for a very comprehensive talk on the different aspects of surgical training. So I think we start with the...
Yeah, next speaker, I would like to invite Dr. Sanjay Kumar Daulat Thakur to speak in favor of training in wet lab before surgery on patient is required.
Excuse Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be speaking for the motion. Benjamin Franklin said, "Tell me and I forget, teach me and I remember, involve me and I learn." So the transfer of surgical skills from one generation to next usually followed the apprenticeship model of see one, do one, and teach one. But unfortunately, there are real-time pressures during the procedure, and the patient can be an unforgiving teacher. It is less acceptable in the modern world because of high expectations of the patients and decreased tolerance to medical errors. There are also legal and ethical concerns in terms of disclosure and informed consent. So, safety and efficacy cannot be sacrificed for educational purposes. What are the problems with this model? The attending surgeon is primarily an observer with limited ability to intervene. Secondly, it is very difficult to give real-time feedback because the patients are awake. And any error in the early stage of the procedure can lead to downstream complications. And more importantly, intraocular microsurgery has a narrow tolerance for intraoperative error. So, to address the ethical and the practical issues of surgical teaching, a wet lab is essential. All the evidences support us. Ramani et al. Reported decreased frequency of intraoperative complications and better postoperative visual outcome in residents who had undergone wet lab training. Similarly, Bailey and other colleagues reported reduced phaco time, phaco power, and complications rate. Pantanelli et al. Reported reduced incidence of posterior capsular tears. It is now globally accepted that wet lab is essential. The Accreditation Council of US requires residencies have either a wet lab or a surgical simulator. The Royal College of Ophthalmologists expects trainees to undertake a simulation on a regular basis. In India, it is now adopted by almost all the tertiary care centers. The classical wet lab training of Arvind Eye Care System includes practice of suturing techniques under the operating microscope, use of goat's eyes and cadaver's eyes to practice different surgical steps, followed by use of surgical simulators, and then instruction in phacoemulsification technique using a goat eye model before moving to live surgery. There are many advantages of wet lab. Skills can be developed by practice and repetition. Trainees can practice in a safe environment with permission to fail and learn the natural consequences of the mistakes. The learning environment is less stressful and stress is recognized as a barrier to learning. It enhances the confidence and the surgical skills of the residents. Even the residents in the feedback have mentioned that it improved the knowledge with regards to surgical instruments and provided an opportunity to practice technical maneuvers. To summarize, it helps the residents to master the hand-eye coordination, establishes tissue dexterity, tissue awareness, dexterity, and muscle memory required to perform each step. It reduces complications and improves visual outcomes, and overall it boosts the confidence of the trainee. You'll be surprised to know that simulation has been practiced in India as long as 600 BC when Sushruta used clay and leaf models to simulate a forehead flap nasal reconstruction. With India being considered as one of the centers of global excellence, wet lab should be incorporated in all residency programs. Thank you, and I invite you to the All India Conference next year.
I can't access it here. How do I change the slides? Is it that side? Yeah? Good afternoon. So I am with the stand that wet lab is not needed for surgical training of residents. I will be defending my stand using three statements. Statement one, what we usually do here now as young ophthalmologists is dry practice. There's a huge difference between wet lab and dry practice. What is dry practice? Practice of surgical steps in a sterile or unsterile area on dry objects that mimic texture of ocular tissue. Example, tunnel construction on IOL cardboard, capsulorhexis on plastic cover of IOL box. So it actually needs nothing separately. You can use the usual OT microscope. Separate instruments are not needed, and no model eye is needed. This is the option that is available to most residents in our Indian setup. And this is what we started with. Whereas what is a wet lab? A wet lab is defined as a separate demarcated unsterile area for practice of various surgical steps on a model eye. It needs a separate microscope, it needs separate instruments, and it needs goat, pig, expired donor corneas or wax eyes. And most importantly, it needs money. This is what we all have done initially, and this is a wet lab. Most institutes in Indian setup cannot afford a separate wet lab. There's separate cost of microscope instruments and model eyes. Phaco and vitrectomy simulator costs goes in lakhs. Does this mean that our residents should not have hands-on? Not at all. I have used this traffic signal theory to kind of separate the surgical steps into red, orange, and green. Red is do not proceed without wet lab. In the sense, wet lab is definitely needed in these surgical steps. For example, nucleus management in phacoemulsification. For orange is dry practice and then perform under supervision. ECC suturing. After dry practice on foam, you can do it. Dry lab of tunnel construction in SICS. Capsulorhexis. And suturing donor graft to host and penetrating keratoplasty. These can be done after practicing suturing on the suture material. And then there are green surgeries, by which I mean first case should be done under supervision, meticulous study of theory, videos, and observing many cases. Most of these surgeries have no wet lab for them as such, except LASIK. That includes Calesion, Pterygium, Tarsorrhaphy, PRK, and intravitreal injections. To conclude, statement one, dry practice can be done, and it is what most of us have done. Statement two, most institutes cannot offer a separate wet lab setup. In India, I'm not talking about international institutes, and the traffic signal theory. That means there are some steps that can be, that do definitely need a wet lab practice, but then there are others which you can go ahead with dry practice. Last but not the least, absence of a wet lab should not stop a capable resident from getting the surgical training he or she deserves. Thank you.
Dr. Rakesh, what are your comments regarding this importance of wet lab training for the residents?
Yeah, I think wet lab is a very, very essential, very important. Though wet lab surgeries can be done only for few procedures, like if you have to learn a squint surgery, if you have to learn a pterygium, if you have to learn DCR. So wet lab is not the solution for that because it's not available. So you have to be assisted by somebody senior, which I am going to talk next talk. But certain procedures, especially the cataract, whether you do a ECC, whether you do a phacoemulsification, I think it's one of the most important that wet lab should be there. Because residents going directly onto a patient's eye and then ending up with problems, then you end up having legal problems. So I think some of the steps, not that each step you will learn in a wet lab, but we have set up a wet lab. So we train residents to do some of the suturings on that. We teach them how to do capsulorhexis, wound entry, even like if you end up having a wound which is a little bigger in a patient itself and your wound is leaking all the time, then you end up finishing that case. Then it is not possible to go ahead with the surgery which you have planned in a patient. So I think though it was for the purpose of just telling those steps that it may not be required, but I think it's a need of the hour. If not wet lab, then simulator surgery, which is still more costly. Like if you have to buy a simulator, it's costing 1.5 crore rupees. So only the good institutions, those who have a lot of funding in the teaching and all, they can only afford those simulators. But I think setting up a wet lab with a simple microscope and getting goat's eye or pig eye, it's not very costly. And instruments, he said, you don't have to have a separate set. Usually the instruments, the cheap ones you can buy, they are available, and they do help us in learning some of the good steps. And your hands will never be shaky if you have done few steps on the goat's eye, and when you go on to the patient, you feel a little more confident at least.
Yeah,
that's my view.
You don't require these Zeiss microscope to do start your wet lab training. You can do it under APPA.
Yeah, that's what I said. You don't have to go get very costly microscopes. So 15, 20,000, even 50,000 microscopes are available. And some of the companies are ready to give it free also.
Yeah.
So only thing your department head has to go for it and see how they can, deal with the companies and all. So they're ready to give free microscopes, and getting those goat's eye and animal eyes is not very difficult.
I think in the interest of the patient's, safety of the eye and giving excellent results to the patients.
Yeah.
Wet lab, I think, plays a very important role.
So there's one point, this is something that I've been thinking about and we've been discussing quite some time, that you take cheap instruments and you take the same. In terms of learning a car, even I did the same thing. I learned first on a Maruti 800 and then do something like that. So, but when it comes to blades and things like that, I feel training the residents on a more better instrument, it makes more sense rather than allowing them to learn on a worse instrument, because you put me on you give me a better blade, you give me this thing, you realize that I don't get those complications when I do those. So I tell people that I sometimes in the past I used to use old instruments and I say, ye blade maine 6 bar use kiya hai, aap use kar do. No, and then you realize that no. Then I say, no, tumko to kuch nahi aata. No? So you end up saying that you don't know anything because you've given them the wrong instrument.
We always provide our resident the best of the instruments.
Not the best of the instrument, because even I don't have the best of the instruments. there's something called in terms of toxicology. It gets toxic. So toxicology, Paracelsus, Solazoic facet venenum. So Solazoic facet venenum is the dose is the poison. So if I give a very bad instrument, that's a very low dose, you can kill me
bad.
With no water dehydration, you can kill
that's
me with over water.
Thing.
So you base somewhere in between. So yeah. You're not even giving very bad instruments, you're not even getting the best of instruments. So that's what.
The thing is to hand eye coordination is a must.
Yeah, that's a more important point. The instruments, blades and all, even if you buy a set of new instruments, especially the side port and the main port, they're not very costly. You can get them for 50 rupees, 70 rupees, a blade which will be sufficient on an animal eye. Yeah.
Just a small practical pursuit to answer one of the points that Shiraj is very costly to set up an instrument. It's probably the problem with most. It's not just costly, the official problems in any medical college to set a wet lab. There are a lot of procedures and procedural delays. I think one small thing I can probably share, this is a very success story of a medical college where there were things. The department was keen, but there was problem, procedural delays and problems. So what they did was, every resident who was getting sufficient stipend, they contributed 10,000. So there were some 30 residents, they made 3 lakhs. So 3 lakhs was good enough to buy a second-hand upper Assami microscope and whatever they could do it. In fact, so what happened, they trained. So now they had their own microscope. Now the HOD cannot say no. So they had all the training properly well done. And in fact, when they left, they sold those shares to the next incoming PGs. So they got the 10,000 also back. In fact, looking at that, the Appa Swami gave 2 more microscopes. So I think where there is a will, there is a way.
Yeah.
I think cost cannot be only kept as a hurdle, which can be probably overstated.
It's a matter of interest among the residents also.
I think we can end up this discussion. I think wet lab is a necessity. These days, especially when we have a lot of issues with the legal problems which we face if we straight away go ahead with the surgery on a patient. So the next talk we have is resident to do the surgery, whether from the first year or from the second year. So the first speaker we have Dr. Anita Zabar, is there? Dr. Anita? Oh, she's not there. Then we Dr. Gautam. Dr. Gautam is there? Okay.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks to our chairman, CSC, Dr. Partha, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. My topic is to resident to do surgery from second year. Myself, Dr. Gautam. What is ophthalmology? Ophthalmology is the study of medical condition relating to the eyes. And an ophthalmologist is a medical doctor, specializes in diagnosing and treating the eye-related conditions. To practice in India, ophthalmologists must complete 4.5 years of the graduate medical degree, 2 years of postgraduate diploma, or and 36 months of junior residency of MDMS. Ophthalmic residents should learn theory, clinical examination, diagnosis, refraction, instrument handling, and surgery in this period. So, learning the clinical diagnosis is the soul of ophthalmic practice. Refraction and learning of instrument handling are as important as surgery. Learning the interpretations of gonioscopy, HFA printout, OCT printout, UBM, BA scan, slit lamp biomicroscopy, direct and indirect ophthalmoscopy is must. And refraction and retinoscopy is an art, and it must be learned by all the residents. It should be under supervision of senior teachers. And ophthalmologist has to perform the extremely intricate surgery on delicate part of the eye. So it is similar. It is not similar to the general surgery. We know it is mostly microscopic surgery, and residents should learn to operate on microscope, knowing their own IPDs, and he should learn hand-eye coordinations. And these are the various surgery on which a resident should perform. Now, after watching the overview of the syllabus of resident, now planning for teaching become easy. In first year, residents should learn instrument handling, learn gonioscopy, HFA, BA scan, AS scan, UBM, indirect ophthalmoscopy, slit lamp biomicroscopy, retinoscopy, and refraction. And in my view, first year residents should learn instrument handling. So before doing surgical practice on human eye, bat lab training for being familiar for surgical techniques, hand-eye coordination under microscope, learn scrub protocol. So my view, junior resident should learn all these in first year of residency. And from second year, a step-by-step training module on human eye can be started. And there is some general review. One general review is Indian Journal of Ophthalmology published in 2014. Feedback of pioneer ophthalmology postgraduate about their residency ophthalmology training in South India. This study was done by the KJ and R. Krishna Prasad sir. And aim of this study was to study documents a survey of final year ophthalmology postgraduate student on the subject of their residency training. And there is some question I asked used in the article, which is the best method to learn ophthalmology resident doctors, perspective of ophthalmologic training published in IGO volume 5, and results were the most student desired an orientation program of interning residency and wished to undergo diagnostic training initially, and case presentation with the demonstration and wet lab learning were most preferred. There is some another study also, and one study is published in 2008 in IGO, which is the best method to learn ophthalmology resident doctor perspective of ophthalmologic training. This is a study done by the Prakshit Gogti sir, Madan Deshpande and Sital. And result was the most student wanted basic ophthalmology and refraction to be taught more with emphasis on squint and neuro-ophthalmology. They wanted more hands-on training, experience in using basic diagnostic procedure. Thank you very much.
Dr. Bijuli, what are your comments regarding the same, giving surgical exposure to the first year residents?
They should get accustomed with the medical part, medical management part, handling the, doing the clinical examination, how to do the slit lamp examination, retinal fundus examination, and all those clinical part. And also they should go to the wet lab to do the, to practice the basic steps, how to handling the microscope and the different preliminary steps of cataract surgery, mainly cataract surgery, they should try. They should go.
Okay. Now, yeah, I'd like to.
Or at least some of the minor procedures during the first year, like they can be taught about the Calesian surgery, pterygium surgery, entropion, ectropion.
Even conjunctival flap making.
Conjunctival flap making also. Yeah, some of the procedures can definitely, especially after first year of training once they know a little bit about that.
Second year resident surgical teaching by senior resident or fellow versus faculty member. I would like to invite Dr. Rakesh Bansal to speak on surgical teaching by senior resident or fellow.
अच्छा प्ले कर देंगे तो आ जाएगा. ओके थैंक यू. सो माय टॉक इज रिगार्डिंग द ट्रेनिंग ऑफ द सेकंड ईयर रेजिडेंट्स वेदर शुड बी डन बाय द सीनियर रेजिडेंट और बाय द फैकल्टी मेंबर्स. वी ऑलरेडी डिस्कस लॉट अबाउट द सर्जिकल ट्रेनिंग एंड वी नो इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट दैट सर्जिकल ट्रेनिंग शुड बी गिवन बाय द टीचर्स टू द रेजिडेंट्स एंड टीचिंग इन ऑपरेटिंग रूम इज अ कॉम्प्लिकेटेड बाय द फैक्ट दैट द अटेंडिंग फैकल्टी मेंबर यूजुअली an observer, he may not be standing by the resident to train him. And there are some of the procedures we should know that resident, the senior resident or the senior, the third year resident even can teach to the second year resident. So they should start learning some of the steps of phacoemulsification, small incision cardiac surgery, some steps of glaucoma surgery, squint surgery, and even DCR. The purpose of surgical training to the resident is that when they go out, they should be able to do a safe and independent practice in ophthalmology. There are a lot of surveys, and it has been seen that the phacoemulsification, which has been taught to the residents, patients are even able to achieve about 20-40 vision to the extent of 80% of the patients who undergo surgery by the residents. So senior residents play a very important role for the hands-on training providing to the second year and the third year residents. If we go into the number of procedures which can be taught, there are a lot of procedures we can. I have made a short list like application of glue, some steps of penetrating keratoplasty, stromal punctures, lamellar keratoplasty, tracheum with a graft, lid repairs, and even steps of phacoemulsification and small incision cardiac surgery, DCR, DCT, and repair of corneal lacerations and assist in the cross-linking thing. The main problem we have been facing is that there are a lot of expectations as far the number of surgeries is concerned. So we look at that the ideal resident should be doing a lot of surgeries, but actually they end up performing much less surgeries. So thing is that whatever number of surgeries they are able to perform, they should be able to do in a better way so that they are more confident when they go. So the question is whether the training should be provided by the senior resident or by the faculty member. So resident to resident training is very vital. We know some of the steps definitely can be taught to the residents by the senior most resident. The only advantage is that this has a more friendly approach, like a second year resident asking a senior resident to come and help whenever there is a problem. It's not very difficult, but the same resident asking a faculty member may find it difficult to call the senior the faculty member and come for assist if there is some complication occurs. So senior residents can definitely easily take over the patient in case of there is any complications. So faculty member usually remains an observant. So though the facility is available, that faculty member can be called and can assist or take up the case if there is a complication like PC rent or the anterior capsular axis go haywire. So some of faculty member is definitely available, but if we expect that each faculty member will be teaching the second year resident, then it's a little, practically it's a little more difficult. There was one article published in 2019 from Saudi Arabia, and which says that adequate space and OT tables should be available for the residents, and there should be supervisors who are interested in teaching the surgery to the residents. And there should also be a suitable case which can be given to a second year resident, and also there should be willingness from the patient also, whether the patient is willing to undergo surgery by the resident. And we need to explain that there is a high rate of complication, but I don't think this really happens in the real life where we tell the patient that you are going to be operated by a resident or a training, then the patient may not really agree. So that part still we need to look at whether we can really inform the patient that patient is going to be operated by a resident. As we discussed earlier also, the simulation surgery and the wet lab. So it's definitely catching up. If the residents are able to put their hands on the simulator, are able to do on the animal eyes, I think then they are better trained and they can easily take over the patients. So this study has shown that the rate of complication is a little high if the resident is trained by a novice trainer like a senior resident compared to an experienced faculty member where the rate of complications like vitreous loss, anterior capsular tear and all is much less. So comparing the resident surgery by a experienced surgeon, definitely we know that there is a little more risk involved. The rate of complication is a little high, but the senior residents are easily available in the OT, and whatever complication occurs, they are able to take over the case. So I do recommend that the training by the senior resident should be part of the curriculum, and they should be training the second year or even a third year resident as far as the surgical training is concerned. We don't look at only at the phacoemulsification, but I think we should look at the other surgeries also where the resident have to do direct surgeries, like I mentioned squint surgeries, trigem surgeries, some lid surgeries, because we don't have wet labs for that. So there only the help of the resident, senior resident comes, where they need to learn from them also. Thank you.
Dr. Ruchika Agarwal, to speak in favor of surgical teaching by faculty member.
A very good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to thank Dr. Partha and ARC team for giving me this wonderful opportunity. I'll be talking about surgical training by faculty member. And when we talk about surgical training during residency, we mostly talk about cataract surgery because it's the cornerstone of residency training. And we know the various challenges we face in during cataract surgery. That is a microsurgery, so only one operating surgeon at a time. We operate inside the eye. There's a little room for error. Patients are awake, so there is a difficulty in giving real-time feedback between the mentor and the trainee. And it is a combination of 100 minute steps that build on each other to deliver the final outcome, each step having its own implication. So when we talk about an effective mentor, he should be no doubt be a skilled surgeon, but he should also be an effective communicator. And besides skill, patience and courage is needed to attend the residence. No doubt, as Dr. Rakesh very nicely said, by training by fellow or senior residents make you feel more comfortable for the initial steps and avoids that pre-op tachycardia and nervousness, and make you more confident that it's more likely you might complete the case despite your few faults. But when we talk about training by a faculty member, the faculty member, the only difference is more experienced. And this adds on to lots of things. Like first of all, when the resident is operating, he is sure that a senior skilled surgeon is sitting next to him and take care of it, and the final outcome will be good. And training by a faculty member, again, he is well versed in tackling all sorts of complications. So he is confident to allow the trainee to perform various steps in a freehand manner. He's also well versed with the commonest steps where a trainee can go wrong, so he can warn prior to committing the mistakes, resulting in a better surgical outcome. Besides this, if things go wrong, I feel because of the experience and the number of surgery as a faculty the person has performed, he will be more patient if things go wrong, as he know that to begin with, the residents might perform bad initially and they do wonders later. And then they make you technically sound rather just focusing on completion of steps. They can critically observe the operating surgeon, their individual steps, and can correct the actual problem. For example, the hold grip of the instruments, the movement of the hand during rexes, and various techniques. So besides this, these are the other ways to enhance your surgical skills using eye simulators, in-depth understanding of theoretical aspects, observing live surgeries, watching your own surgical videos prior to the surgery. And besides this, a positive reinforcement that yes, you can do it. That's it. Thank you.
Shalom, what is your experience regarding these surgical teaching by the residents or by the faculty?
I think the teaching by the residents definitely under the supervision of the faculty would be ideal situation, and I think the presentation was excellent, and at the end of your talk I would just add one word: it depends on who the faculty is. If the faculty is an excellent teacher and if the faculty is a very friendly person, you know, who would make the resident comfortable, I think that was the take home message for all of us. Thank you.
Yeah, I think so. I think if the faculty member is available and if he can afford time for the training, there is nothing like that.
The only problem with the faculty member is that because the residents take a lot of time to perform a simple procedure also. So he has to have that patience. That patience is very important because they have to sit all along the resident on the assistant microscope and keep watching the steps and all. So if, as you said, if faculty member is, has a lot of patience.
Needs to be very friendly and patient.
Friendly and patient, yeah. So after that, we go to the third year residents. So whether they should be doing independent surgery versus a supervised surgery. So on the independent surgery, Dr. Muhammad Sahid Alam is going to talk.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'll be talking for non-supervised independent surgeries for third year residents in ophthalmology. So just to put the current scenario of ophthalmological surgical training in India, see that the open eye on the left, which is the left eye, obviously, is a third year resident who has done all the mundane activities in like ward duties, eye donation calls. He has done his thesis work, clinical duties. While the covered right eye is a like surgical expertise that he gets during his 3 years of training. So what is expected? So as we see in this current article published by Grover et al, we can see there are like a lot of times they have emphasized upon like what all surgeries that should be performed independently by the end of a residency of an ophthalmic resident. He should be well versed with all kinds of block. He should be able to perform independent surgery, and not only able to perform independent surgery, but at the same time, he should be able to tackle all the different kinds of complications of all these lid surgeries, destructive procedures like enucleation, evisceration, sac surgeries, strabismus surgeries. He should be able to perform surgeries under microscopes. And the most common surgery, like the bread and butter of ophthalmology, which is the cataract surgery. And he should also be, if not able to perform independently, he should be well versed with different steps of vitreoretinal procedures like vitrectomies. So this is expected from a third year resident of ophthalmology. So now just to take idea, like how is the training abroad and what should be the proposal for India? And taking the two common models of US and UK, in US it's, the program is of 3 years duration, and the number they have recommended that a postgraduate should do at the end of their training is 86, and most of them, they end up doing somewhere around 120 of surgeries. While in UK it's a 7 years program, the number recommended is 350, and they end up doing around above 500 cataract surgeries. And our article published by Daliwal et al, they have proposed that at least the residents should do 80 surgeries independently. Independent 80 surgeries, cataract surgery, which should include 40 SICS and 40 FACO. Likewise, numbers for TRAPS, RDs, plastic surgeries, and trauma. And what do postgraduates say? So on the number like which is displayed here, it's not a mobile number. It's the median of different kind of surgeries that is being listed in the table. You see the median for ECC is 17, for SICS is 2, and it's 0 for FACOs, and even for a surgery like pterygium, it's 0. So what to talk of other specialty surgeries? And this was the article published in 2008, and a similar article published in 2014 doesn't also put encouraging figures where the median number for cataract surgeries was 19. So what is essential? So this article by Grover et al, they say that at least the bare minimum of cataract surgery that PG should do independently is 50, and 5 each of glaucoma surgeries, squint surgeries, eyelid surgeries, sac surgeries, and eye retrieval procedures. The point of concern is this recent article published in 2017, which says that the median number of surgeries performed and by a resident at the end of his training is 55 for SICS, 30 Calasion, 18 ECC, and the most common procedure that every ophthalmologist should be aware of, that is FACO, the number was 1. This is the median number of FACO surgery that a resident gets to do at the end of his training. The point of concern was that lowest range, even for surgeries like Calasion and pterygium, was 0. So that is actually a point of concern, and are we like training our residents properly or not? We should look back into it. So what are the possible reasons that this PG, these postgraduates are not being given surgeries? So one of the reasons is inadequate infrastructure or lack of motivation on part of trainees, fear of complications, and not keeping up with advances. And then if the surgery was not given to me when I was a resident, so I will not give surgeries to my residents. And why to give this the best time for developing reflexes? And where else they will find a more comfortable environment than their, like, from where they are doing their PGs. And then that is the best time when they can cope up with complications, and of course it will save precious time, all of them, they have to do to go to do different kinds of fellowships and then adjunct faculties and so on and so forth. So just to conclude, I'll conclude with this picture that, like, at some point of time the supervision has to go and then only the person can learn. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think so. But the data which you showed, one FECO, is it overall India or one institute? But the average, yeah, I know.
No, it's not average, it's
median. Median, because one number is too low.
So for highly skewed data, we need to use the median. Yeah. Mm. And this is highly skewed data because you've got these institutes.
Where there are...
Unfortunately, India has a very high number of ophthalmic physicians. It's only 35 to 40%, according to one data, they are the ophthalmic surgeons. Hmm. So that is a big problem.
And at the same time, we have more number of patients also, cataract patients. The blindness figures, if you see, we India still a lot of cataract patients are there.
In UK and US, it's between 85 to 90%. They are the ophthalmic surgeons.
Yeah.
I think Dr. Mohammed, your statistics and the presentation was excellent, and I think, in my opinion, the Indian surgeons, especially the ophthalmologists, I think are the best in the world because of the volume of work that we do. And the judgment of whether the surgery should be done independent or to be supervised by this, the consultants or the seniors depends on how the consultant judges the skill of the resident. It all depends on the judgment of the consultant. That's one thing. And another thing that I would like to tell is, not all institutes in our country have the same protocol or the same way of teaching. For example, AIIMS, which is considered to be the best in the country, has an excellent teaching program for the residents compared to a private institution. Most of in our country, especially the students, get into the private institution just to get a degree. And once they're out of the college, then they go for the fellowships. So this difference is there in our country, you know. So this is what I think.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am, you would like to say something?
Continuing what ma'am was saying, that is very right, because in most of the institutes, now the faculty is very less as per MCI, and the number of residents
is more increasing.
So
yeah.
No,
each institute is taking more and more residents.
Effectively. Also, I think, as ma'am very rightly said, there is a need for standardization. Just say UG teaching is now going towards a common teaching methodology for all UG graduates. Similarly, I think for PG, not only in all the branches, we can say for ophthalmology, it should be standardized and strictly monitored whether all these things are actually going on or not, so that the residents can actually learn something useful and not plan ki once we get out of PG, to yahan wahan wahan fellowship karna hai.
So a resident who comes out of AIIMS,
yes,
okay,
ma'am,
would do, you know, I think excellent surgery, whereas a resident who comes out from a private medical college, even after coming out of the residency, after getting a degree, a postgraduate degree, even after doing a fellowship, so on an average, the person who is coming from a private college would spend more time, you know, compared to our resident who is coming from an excellent institute. So I think the need of having an excellent institute in our country is very important versus the private colleges where the students just get in to take a degree.
Correct.
I think that's the
yes,
very important thing in our country.
Thank you, ma'am. I think
for program and colleges.
Yeah.
Yeah, it differs, so there's a need for uniformity. So the last talk, we have Dr. Nutan Sunil Shah. She is going to talk about supervised surgical training.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everybody. I think everyone is now, because it's the last talk, talks a little. Straight away, we go to why we should have or why we should not. I'll take all the 3 points, a third year resident. as such, that is the most toxic person of the OT team, because he is exam going, he is the most tense person. Maybe the thesis is still to be done, and actually is still not certified or qualified to be doing a surgery. It is like driving a vehicle without a license is a crime. So what is the hurry of letting the third year resident do independently? Again, it does depend on the institution, but just now we are talking in general for all the teaching institutions. So why not to be supervised? I'll take a little in detail after 3-4 slides. He should be supervised. Supervised doesn't really mean the faculty, as sir has already discussed. It could be one more third year resident itself, could be even a second year who has some idea rather than totally independent. It can be a guide or a help by someone else who has been doing those surgeries, so not necessarily teachers, or it can be a colleague. And the teacher can be around, which is a very big strength in itself. Teacher may not be actually helping during, means washed up during the surgery. Teacher could be around, and it definitely would make a difference. Surgery by itself, we have, it is not a medical part, it is one for all. Like, we don't get a second chance, and we have to take into account the patient's viewpoint, surgeon's viewpoint, and of course the department's viewpoint. So we have to keep all the three things safe. Now suppose we take a very routine cataract surgery, as in most of the things we have talked about, a cataract surgery, getting into trouble at any point is not at all uncommon, even for the experienced hands. So why in our surgical career, and early in the surgical career, we want to expose a third year resident to a nightmare, which, you know, might shake him up? Let his confidence be built up. These small things like a rexis running out, decimates detachment, of course they are third year resident, they would be able to track it, but sometimes they track it much later, and it should have been detected earlier. So early PCR, a sinking Titanic, decision whether IOL should be placed, like messing up the whole thing or leave it, a CTR to be placed or not. And the worst come worst, this has happened when we were residents, expulsive hemorrhage. If it is not detected, I don't think the resident, I mean the surgeon, would forget that patient throughout his life, and the patient would also not forget you throughout his life. Even in the other surgeries, if they are basic ones also, like a scleral buckling, a glaucoma trabeculectomy, the horizontal muscle squint surgery, most of these are not independently given to the third year resident. Most of the times they are given either supervised or after the MS. Now I come back to again, why not supervise surgery? Medical colleges have a good help and resource, then why should not we use them, and why the resident should not be doing the last few surgeries of his career as a student under the best supervision? This would keep the patient happy, the resident would be well tuned, and of course the department remains hassle free. Why we are talking actually against supervised surgery, I thought, why should we even think of it? When we were residents, we were not allowed. The thought may be just because there is a future choice that this person has to now next go and practice solo. This is coming between. Unqualified nursing staff is nowadays not allowed to do a duty of a nurse. So how can an unqualified surgeon be allowed to do an independent surgery? In the era of accreditation I'm talking, medico-legally and with whatever mob violence is occurring, if one is qualified ophthalmologist, it would be a good tool to defend, and an unqualified person ideally should not be allowed to perform surgeries on a live person. Mob violence, we should not just forget. We do not want to risk any of our doctors, nor the patient, nor the hospital. And so don't be in a hurry. This is the message to third year resident. Don't be like, oh, I have not still done independent. Forget it. Learn well from your teachers when teachers are around. Move on and progress in the right way. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think
I want to add, Dr. Nutan, actually we should give the
confidence to the newer surgeon, budding surgeon. That is the main idea, because there are so many cataract backlog is there in our country. So we should give the new surgeon the confidence.
Yes, that's what I thought, that there should be at least one, even a second year resident can be around. Only the third year with the nursing staff, when the person is very tense, it's a little. I didn't have the time, but ideal nowadays with the whatever medical legal things are going on, I thought that when they go into, like, that is what we had done, we should get our colleagues to help each other. Let one colleague is operating in the morning, the other one is operating in the afternoon. It's such a win-win situation. Or it could be a group practice. And that solves most of the problems. You have someone there who will detect, oh, stop, wait, don't panic, don't get afraid. This is what we need as a help.
One more thing I would like to tell is, if at all there is any complication, which can happen even with the senior most surgeon,
with anyone,
and when the resident is operating, I think rather than telling unqualified doctors, we should say that the senior surgeon should take the responsibility of the junior doctor when there is a medical legal case, and he or she should come to the forefront and try to protect the junior.
That's ideal, yes.
You know, strong bondage between the teacher and the student.
No, that is always done, because the whatever case they are doing, it is under the supervision, under the name of the faculty member only.
Resident's so that name part doesn't
is,
come
that
anywhere.
Part is taken care, because that every institute takes care of that. They don't put it on the resident, all the legal issues, that he has done the surgery and he should be sued for that.
We are responsible for the mistake if the anesthetist does or doctor.
I think the last 6 months we should give them time for independent surgery. The third year can be divided into two parts, like first 6 months and the second 6 months. First 6 months, yes, you can supervise them, and if you sure that they are able to perform surgeries,
enough, yes,
then independence should be given, because when they go out, the question is that when they go out, they should be able to do the surgeries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I would like to invite all the speakers to kindly come on the stage for a group photograph.